to help run their government and to oversee the slaves from Israel who had been brought back. The very best that had been selected to serve in his court, and they actually even ate from his table. His eye was immediately drawn to these three, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And I want to tell you a little story of my life. When I was a little boy, my mother didn't believe in once-upon-a-time stories. So when she put me in bed, she would always tell me a story out of the Bible. Might be a story about David. Might be a story about Moses. It might be a story about, But one of the stories she used to tell was about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And for the longest time, I thought that the story was about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But anyway, his eye had been on these three. And as I said, they even ate from his table. These three men were men of integrity and honor and strength, and they were industrious. But the king should have also known that with those three, there was probably, I'm a little loud here, I think, those three were going to bring trouble to the kingdom. As I said twice now, they even ate out of the table. And when the food was served, they said to the king, "Oh, king, this food looks wonderful, and we imagine it tastes good, but we're not allowed to eat it because it's not kosher. So here's what we'd like to do. This is the food we would like to eat. Vegetarian food that needs to be prepared in this way." And at the end of 3 years, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were the strongest and the brightest and the most wonderful of all the rest of those. Now, skipping over a lot of details, their friend Daniel came to the attention of Nebuchadnezzar. And through a whole host of events, Daniel was named governor. And after he was named governor, he appointed his assistants, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, to help him govern the country. They were the most powerful people, aside from the king, in the entire kingdom. And as one might suspect, there were also people who were very, very jealous. Out of the blue, let's forget, one day the king said, "I'm having this image created that actually is an image of me. And it's made out of gold. And at the proper time, I'm going to have people worship this." So they called together a big banquet, a big gala. And they were eating together. And the order was that at a certain place where the music sounded, everyone in the whole kingdom was to fall down and worship this golden image. And when the musicians began to play, everyone did exactly that, except Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So in order to be released from the, out of the prison, and the door was open, and out they walked. Goodbye. Hold truth this sacred guest give a political opinion. I know and help people on all sides of any political discussion. I know people who have strongly held opinions about immigration, about the Middle East, about trade, about the military, about guns, about denial, and people all over the spectrum. And I try to love and understand all of them. Yes, we worship a God who is sovereign. But our opinions are our opinions, and we need to learn to live in that tension with other people who don't agree with us. You know what I'm saying? And that's not always easy to do. One of my 20th century heroes is a theologian by the name of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. In his books, Cost of Discipleship, Life Together, Letters and Papers from Prison, Bonhoeffer lays out his theology. Now, it might be surprising for you to know that Bonhoeffer was assassinated and killed by the Nazis at the end of World War II. Because of his involvement in the attempted assassination of Adolf Hitler, because he believed very strongly that Hitler needed to be stopped so that the carnage and the destruction of the world, as it appeared, would come to an end. How about the same time, it's an amazing distinction, he writes about praying for those who persecute you. He writes about a radical kind of discipleship and how costly it is. Even for Bonhoeffer, the truth had to be held in tension. So not only are we tempted, and not only does our truth have to be held in tension, but the third is trust. Please hear me this morning. No one, no president, no king, no government, no nation is sovereign. The only one who is sovereign is the Lord Jesus Christ. Someone say amen. Amen. I'm listening for you, okay? We put our trust in God. God alone. And worship God for all those other gods out there. In fact, in our worship of God, those other gods begin to fade away. Hear with me for a moment. The difference between humanism and Christianity is radical. Humanism searches for truth with self-consciousness. Cogito ergo sum. I think, therefore I am, in the words of René Descartes. Christianity begins with a whole different worldview, and that is that God is, therefore we are. That's the kind of thinking that characterizes our life. God is, therefore, we are. 158 years ago, Abraham Lincoln was in the midst of the Civil War, a war he hadn't wanted, a war he hadn't looked for. He hated war. At night, unable to sleep, he would often get up and walk around, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And once an aide came to him and said, "Mr. President, why are you so worried? Don't you believe that God is on our side?" In the end. In the end, that's all that matters. So today we pray for our nation. We pray for the world. We pray for the divisions of race, creed, and opinion. Yes.
Thank you. to you, O God. We are thankful for your steadfast love. Worship is a time to offer praise and glory to you. We praise you by singing. We praise you through prayer. We praise you in service. This offering is a worshipful moment of praise, an intentional opportunity to practice hospitable generosity. We pray that these gifts may help our church fulfill its purpose. Even more, we pray that you invite us to use our talents in humble ways to help our church fulfill its purpose. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Now may we go, knowing that we are available.